The Elfin Hill by Hans Christian Andersen. Read by Delilah M. Rainey. A few larger lizards were running nimbly about in the clefts of an old riven tree. They could understand one another very well, for they spoke the lizard's language. "How it grumbles and growls in the old Elfin Hill," said one lizard. "I have not been able to close my eyes for 2 nights on account of the noise. I might just as well lie and have a toothache, for then I can't sleep either." "There is something going on within there," said the other lizard. "They propped up the top of the hill with 4 red posts till cockcrow this morning, so that it is thoroughly aired, and the Elfin girls have learned a new dance. There is something going on." "I spoke about it to an earthworm of my acquaintance," said a third lizard. "The earthworm had just come from the Elfin Hill, where he has been groping about in the earth day and night. He has heard much, although he cannot see, poor miserable creature, yet he understands very well how to wriggle and lurk about. They expect friends in the Elfin Hill, grand strangers too, but who they are the earthworm would not tell, or perhaps indeed he did not know. All the will-o'-the-wisps are ordered to hold a torch dance, as it is called, and silver and gold, of which is plentiful in the hill, is being polished and put out in the moonlight." "Who may these strangers be?" asked the lizards. "What can be going on there? Hark, how it hums! Hark, how it murmurs!" Just at this moment the Elfin Hill opened, and an old Elfin maiden, hollow behind, but otherwise very respectably dressed, came tripping out. She was the old Elf King's housekeeper, and a distant relative of the royal family. Therefore she wore an amber heart in the middle of her forehead. Her feet moved so rapidly, trip, trip, gracious, how she could trip right down to the moss, to the night raven. "You are invited to the Elf Hill for this evening," said she, "but will you do us a great service and undertake the invitations? You ought to do something, as you don't keep house yourself. We shall have some very distinguished friends, conjurers, who have always something to say, and therefore the old Elf King wishes to make a great display." "Who is to be invited?" asked the raven. "To the great ball the world may come, even men, if they can only talk in their sleep or do something after our fashion. But for the feast the company must be carefully selected. We will have only the most distinguished. I have had a dispute myself with the Elf King, for I declared that we could not even admit ghosts. The merman and his daughters must be invited first, although it may not be agreeable to them to remain so long on dry land. But they shall have a whetstone to sit on, or perhaps something better, and then I think they won't refuse this time. All the old demons of the first class, with tails, and the river man and the hobgoblins and imps. And I think we ought not to leave out the death horse or the grave pig or even the church dwarf, although they do belong to the clergy and are not reckoned among our people. But that is merely their office. They are nearly related to us and visit us diligently." "Croak," said the night raven, as he flew away with the invitations. The Elfin maidens were already dancing on the Elf Hill, and they danced in shawls woven from mist and moonshine, and that looks very pretty to those who like such things. The large hall within the Elf Hill was splendidly decorated. The floor had been washed with moonshine, and the walls rubbed with witches' salve, so that they glowed like tulips in the light. In the kitchen were frogs turning on the spit, snail skins with children's fingers in them, and salads of mushroom spawn, damp mussels and marrow of mice and hemlock. Beer brewed by the marsh witch, and gleaming saltpetry wine from the grave cellars. Everything very grand, and rusty nails and church window glass among the sweets. The old elf king had his gold crown polished with powdered slate pencil. It was like that used by the first form, and very difficult for an elf king to obtain. In the bedrooms, curtains were hung up and fastened with the slime of snails. Yes, there was a humming and a murmuring there. "Now we must burn horsehair and pig's bristles as incense," said the elf king, "and then I think I shall have done my part." "Father dear," said the youngest daughter, "shall I hear now who the distinguished strangers are?" "Well, I suppose I must tell you now," he replied. "Two of my daughters must hold themselves prepared to be married, for marriages certainly will take place. The old goblin from Norway yonder, who lives in the ancient Dovre Mountains, and who possesses many rock castles of granite, besides a gold mine which is better than all, so it is thought, is coming with his two sons, who are both seeking a wife. The old goblin is a true and honest Norwegian veteran, merry and straightforward. I know him from old days when we drank brotherhood with one another. He came here once to fetch his wife. Now she is dead. She was the daughter of the king of the chalk rocks of Moen. He took his wife upon the chalk, as the saying is. Oh, how I long to see the old Norwegian goblin again. The lads, they say, are rather rude, forward lads, but perhaps that is belied, and they'll be right enough when they grow older. Let me see that you know how to teach them good manners." "And when will they come?" asked the daughter. "That depends upon the wind and the weather," said the elf king. "They travel economically. They will come when there is a chance, by ship. I wanted them to go across Sweden, but the old one would not incline to that wish. He does not go forward with the times, and that I do not like." Then two will-o'-the-wisps came hopping up, one quicker than the other, so, of course, one arrived first. "They are coming," they cried. "Give me my crown," said the elf king, "and let me stand in the moonshine." And the daughters drew on their shawls and bowed down to the earth. There stood the old goblin of the Dovre Mountains, with the crown of hardened ice and polished fir cones. Moreover, he wore a bear skin and great warm boots. His sons, on the contrary, went with their throats bare and wore no braces, for they were strong men. "Is that a hill?" said the youngest of the lads, and he pointed to the elf hill. "In Norway yonder we should call it a hole." "Boys," said the old goblin, "holes go down, mounds go up. Have you no eyes in your heads?" Then they entered the elf hill, where a select and grand company were assembled, and that in such haste that one might almost say they had been blown together. But for each guest the neatest and pleasantest arrangement had been made. The sea folk sat at table in great water tubs, and they said it was just as if they were at home. All observed the ceremonies of the table, excepting the two young northern goblins, who put their legs on the table and thought it suited them well. "Your feet off the tablecloth," cried the old goblin, and they obeyed, but not immediately. Then they tickled the ladies who waited at table with the fir cones which they carried in their pockets. They took off their boots that they might be more at ease and gave them to the ladies to hold. But their father, the old Dovre goblin, was quite different from them. He told such fine stories of the proud Norwegian rocks and of the waterfalls which dashed over them with a clattering noise like thunder and the sound of organs, spreading their white foam on every side. He told of the salmon that leaps up against the falling water when Neken, the water god, plays on his golden harp. He told of shining winter nights, when the sledge bells sound and the lads run with burning torches across the smooth ice, which is so transparent that they can see the fishes dart forward beneath their feet. He described everything so clearly that those who listened could see it all. They could see the sawmills going, the manservants and the maidens singing songs and dancing a rattling dance. when all at once the old goblin gave the old elfin maiden a kiss, such a tremendous kiss, and yet they were almost strangers to each other. Then the elfin girls had to dance, first in the usual way, and then with stamping feet, which they performed very well. Then followed the artistic and solo dance. Dear me, how they did throw their legs about! No one could tell where the dance began or where it ended, nor indeed which were legs and which were arms, for they were all flying about together like the shavings in a sawpit. And then they spun round so quickly that the death horse and the grave pig became sick and giddy and were obliged to leave the table. "That's the way to use one's legs," cried the old goblin. "But what can they do more than dance, stretch out their legs and make a whirlwind?" "You shall soon see what they can do," said the elf king, and then he called his youngest daughter to him. She was as light and graceful as moonshine, and the most delicate of all her sisters. She took a white peg in her mouth, and then she was quite gone. That was her art. But the old goblin said he should not like his wife to possess this art, and thought his boys would have the same objection. Another daughter could make a figure like herself walk beside her, as if she had a shadow, and the goblin people had none. The third was of quite a different sort. She had learned in the brewhouse of the Moor Witch how to lard elfin puddings with glowworms. "She will make a good housewife," said the old goblin, and then saluted her with his eyes instead of drinking her health, for he did not drink much. Now came the fourth, and she had a great harp to play upon, and when she struck the first chord, everyone lifted up the left leg, for the goblins are left-legged, and at the second chord they found that they were all compelled to do as she wished. "That is a dangerous woman," said the old goblin, but the two sons walked out of the hill, for they had had enough of it. "And what can the next daughter do?" asked the old goblin. "I have learned everything that is Norwegian," said she, "and I will never marry unless I can go to Norway." But the youngest sister whispered to the old goblin, "That is only because she has heard in a Norwegian song that when the world shall decay, the cliffs of Norway will remain standing like monuments, and she wants to get there that she may be safe, for she is so afraid of sinking."
"Is that what she means?" said the old goblin. "Well, what can the seventh and last do?"
"The sixth comes before the seventh," said the old elf king, for he could reckon, but the sixth would not come forward. "I can only tell people the truth," said she. "No one cares for me, nor troubles himself about me, and I have enough to do to sew my grave clothes." Now came the seventh and last. And what could she do? Why, she could tell stories, as many as she wished. "Here are all my five fingers," said the old goblin. "Now tell me a story for each of them." So she took him by the wrist, and he laughed till it clucked within him. And when she came to the fourth finger, there was a gold ring around its waist, as if it knew there was to be a wedding. Then the old goblin said, "Hold fast what you have. The hand is yours, for I will have you for my own wife." Then the elfin girl said that the stories about the ring finger and little Peter Playman had not yet been told. "We will hear them in the winter, and we'll hear of the pine tree and the birch, and of the ghosts and the fairies' gifts, and of the biting frost. You shall tell your tales, for no one up there can do it so well. And we will sit in the stone rooms where the pine logs burn and drink mead out of the horns of the old Norwegian kings. The water god has given me too. And when we sit there and the brownie comes on a visit, he'll sing you all the songs of the milking girls in the mountains. How merry we shall be. The salmon will be leaping in the waterfalls and dashing against the stone walls, but he will not be able to come in. It is indeed very pleasant to live in old Norway. But where are the lads?"
Where indeed were they? They were running about in the field and blowing out the will-o'-the-wisps, who so good-naturedly had come to light the procession. "What romping about is that?" said the old goblin. "I have taken a mother for you, and now you must take one of your aunts." But the lads said they would rather make a speech and drink brotherhood. They did not care to marry, and they made speeches and drank toasts and tipped their glasses to show that they were empty. Afterwards, they took their coats off and lay down on the table to sleep, for they made no ceremony. But the old goblin danced about the room with his young bride, and he changed boots with her, for that's more fashionable than changing rings. "Now the cock crows," said the old elfin maiden who attended to the housekeeping. "Now we must close the shutters, that the sun may not scorch us." And the hill shut itself up. But outside, the lizards ran up and down the riven tree, and one said to the other, "Oh, how I like that old Norwegian goblin." "The lads I liked better," said the earthworm. But then the poor miserable creature could not see. The end.